lecture we have started a new chapter, and that lecture we have talked about environment and its effect on human beings as well as human's effect on environment. In today's lecture we will discuss some social problems that affect human behavior. The first problem is poverty and discrimination. Everyone agrees that poverty is a curse on society, and the more quickly we get rid of it, the better it will be for our society. What is poverty? Some experts define poverty mainly in economic terms and measure it in terms of income, nutrition, and the amount spent on basic necessities of life such as food, clothing, and shelter. But from the socio-psychological point of view, the definition of the poverty is different. Like, poverty is that condition in which there is a lack of necessities of life in the context of unequal distribution of wealth in society. Poverty refers to an actual shortage of the resources necessary for living. And what is discrimination? Social disadvantage because of caste and poverty has created the problem of discrimination. We can see the problem of discrimination in our society on the basis of poverty and caste. Now we will discuss about the effects of poverty and deprivation. The first is low aspirations. In terms of motivation, the poor have low aspirations and low achievement. Motivation and high need for dependence. The poor explain their success in terms of luck rather than ability or hard work. The second is low self-esteem. With regard to personality, the poor and deprived have low self-esteem, are high on anxiety and introversion. They prefer smaller immediate rewards to larger rewards in the longer run, because in their perception the future is too uncertain. They live with a sense of hopelessness, powerlessness, felt injustice, and experience a loss of identity. The third is low level of performance. Among the effects of prolonged deprivation on cognitive functioning, it has been found that intellectual functioning and performance on tasks such as classification, verbal reasoning, time perception is lower among the highly deprived compared to those who are less deprived. The fourth is mental disorders. With regard to mental health, there is an unquestionable relationship between mental disorders and poverty or deprivation. The poor are more likely to suffer from specific mental illness compared to rich, possibly due to the constant worriness about basic necessities, feeling of insecurity. They also have emotional and adjustment problem. The last is lack of social skills. With respect to social behavior, the poor and deprived sections exhibit an attitude of resentment towards the rest of society. Now we will discuss the major causes of poverty. Poverty is sometimes caused by natural disasters such as earthquakes, floods, and cyclones, or man-made disasters such as poisonous gas leaks. When such events take place, people suddenly lose their possessions and have to face poverty. Apart from these causes, other factors are also responsible for poverty, like the first is the poor themselves are responsible for their poverty. According to this view, the poor are responsible for their poverty. According to this view, the poor lack the ability and motivation to put in efforts and make use of available opportunities. The second is belief in culture of poverty. This belief culture of poverty convinces the person that he will continue to remain poor, and the belief is carried over from one generation of the poor to the next. The third is economic, social, and political factors together account for poverty. Because of discrimination, certain sections of society are denied the opportunities needed for getting even the basic necessities of life. The fourth, the geographical reason in which one lives is said to be a significant cause of poverty. The geographic reason in which one lives is said to be a significant cause of poverty. For example, people living in regions such as deserts that have a shortage of natural resources and a harsh climate end up being poor. The last is the poverty cycle is an important cause of poverty. The poverty cycle is another important cause of poverty that explains why poverty tends to continue among the some sections of society. Now the measures for poverty alleviation. The first is breaking the poverty cycle. Breaking the poverty cycle and helping the poor to attain self-sufficiency, initially financial relief, medical and other facilities may have to be provided to the poor. The second, providing educational and employment opportunities. Following the principles of social justice, this step may help the poor to discover their own abilities and skills, thus enabling them to come up to the level of other sections of society. The third, measures for improved mental health. Many of the poverty reduction measures help to improve the physical health of the poor, but their mental health will remain as a problem to be tackled effectively. Fourth, steps for empowering the poor. The poor should be made more powerful, capable of living independently and with dignity, without depending on the help given by the government or other groups. Now we will take the another social problem, aggression, violence and peace. Aggression and violence are the major problems in today's society, and they cover a wide range of behaviors, from bragging of newcomers in educational institutions through child abuse, domestic violence, murder and rape, etc. What is aggression? Psychologists use the term aggression to refer to any behavior by one person that is intended to cause harm to another person. It can be demonstrated in actual actions or through the use of harsh words or criticism or even hostile feeling against others. Harm or damages somebody, something physically. Forceful, destructive behavior towards another person or object is described as violence. Now the question is, what is the difference between aggression and violence? Aggressive behavior involves the intention to harm another person, whereas the violence may or may not involve such an intention. For example, burning buses or other public property during a riot is called a violence as well as aggression. But suppose you see a person kicking a motorbike violently, his intention may be only to start the vehicle. Therefore, this act will not be considered a case of aggression. On the other hand, the person may also perform the violent act in order to damage the vehicle because it belongs to a person he dislikes. In this case, harm was intended, the act would be called a case of aggression. Now the causes of aggression. The first is inborn tendency. Aggressiveness is an inborn tendency among human beings. Biographically, this inborn tendency may be meant for self-defense. The second is physiological mechanism. Aggression could also be indirectly triggered by physiological mechanism, especially by the activation of certain parts of the brain that play a role in emotional experience. A general physiological state of arousal or feeling activated might often be expressed in the form of expression. There could be several factors that cause arousal. For example, in the starting of this chapter, we have seen that aggression can result from a sense of crowding, especially in hot and humid weather. The third is child rearing. The way an individual is brought up often influences his aggressiveness. For example, children whose parents use physical punishment end up becoming more aggressive than children whose parents use other disciplinary techniques. This could be because the parents has set an example of aggressive behavior which the child imitates. The next is frustration. Aggression is an expression and consequence of frustration. About frustration, you have read in your previous class, frustration arises when a person is prevented from reaching a goal or attaining an object that he wants. It has been found that people in frustrated situations show more aggression than those who are not frustrated. An American psychologist, John Dollard, conducted research especially to examine the frustration-aggression theory. This theory proposes that it is frustration that leads to aggression. The last is observing an aggressive model. Albert Bandura and his collaborations show the role of modeling in learning aggression. If a child observes aggression and violence on television, he may start imitating that behavior. Here we will discuss the strategies to reduce aggression and violence. The first, parents and teachers should be specially careful not to encourage or reward aggression in any form. The use of punishment to bring about discipline also needs to be changed. It means parents and teachers ko kabhi bhi directly ya indirectly aggressiveness ko promote nahi karna chahiye, because parents and teachers are the role model for a student. The second, opportunities to observe and imitate the behavior of aggression models should be reduced drastically. Portraying aggression as heroic behavior should be particularly avoided, because this may set the stage for learning through observation. The third, implementing social justice. अगर सभी को इक्वल अपॉर्चुनिटीज प्रोवाइड कराई जाएं, देन इट विल हेल्प इन रिड्यूसिंग फ्रस्ट्रेशन लेवल्स एंड देयर बाय कर्व एग्रेसिव टेंडेंसीज एट लास्ट टू सम एक्सटेंट. द लास्ट, एट द लेवल ऑफ द कम्युनिटी और सोसाइटी इट इज इम्पॉर्टेंट टू इनकलकेट अ पॉजिटिव एटीट्यूड टुवर्ड्स पीस. कम्युनिटी लेवल पर भी हमें एग्रेशन वायलेंस को प्रमोट ना करके पीस एंड नॉन वायलेंस को प्रमोट करना चाहिए. आफ्टर ऑल ह्यूमन इज द पार्ट ऑफ सोसाइटी. नेक्स्ट टॉपिक इज हेल्थ. इन जनरल वे हेल्थ इज द स्टेट ऑफ बीइंग फ्री फ्रॉम इलनेस और इंजरी. नाउ द डेफिनेशन अकॉर्डिंग टू WHO. Health is a state of complete physical, mental and social well-being, and not merely the absence of disease or infirmity that enables one to lead a socially and economically productive life. It includes biological, psychological and social aspects of health. It focuses not only physical but also on mental and spiritual aspects of health. Health and illness are a matter of degree. One may be suffering from a physically disabling disease but may be quite healthy. Like Stephen Hawking, suffering from crippling disease but had made great contribution in his field. Now we will discuss the factors influencing health. The first factor is cognition. You may have observed how some people are quick to seek doctor's help while others do not if they are suffering from such symptoms like cold, smallpox, etc. Hamara level of awareness bhi health par bahut effect dalta hai. Primary stage par hame symptoms ko lekar kitne alert hain, ye sab hamari health par effect dalte hain. The second is behavior. Psychologists have found strong evidence which shows that behaviors we engage in and our lifestyles greatly influence health. ये फैक्टर कॉग्निशन से रिलेट करता है. जो लोग हेल्थ को लेकर कॉन्शियस नहीं होते उनका लाइफ स्टाइल भी अनहेल्दी ही होता है. द लास्ट इज सोशल एंड कल्चरल फैक्टर्स. सोशल एंड कल्चरल डिफरेंसेस में इन्फ्लुएंस अवर फिजियोलॉजिकल रिस्पॉन्सेज एंड मे नॉट बी द सेम अक्रॉस ऑल द कल्चर्स. लाइक इन इंडियन सोसाइटी मेडिकल एडवाइस फॉर अ फीमेल इज ऑफन डिलेड बिकॉज ऑफ various reasons as females are less valued or the shame associated with the disease. Now the last topic is impact of television on behavior. There is no doubt that television has been a useful product of technological progress. However, from the point of its psychological impact of human beings, both positive and negative effects have been observed. Many research studies have inquired into the effects of television viewing on cognitive processes and social behavior, especially in Western cultures. Their findings show a mixed impact. First is large amount of information. First, television provides a large amount of information in an attractive form and in the visual mode, for which it became a powerful medium of instruction. At the same time, because the programs are attractive, children spend huge amounts of time watching them. This reduces their habit of reading and writing and also their outdoor activities such as playing. Second, positive interpersonal attitudes. There are excellent programs that emphasizes positive interpersonal attitudes and provides useful factual information. On the other hand, television watching may have an effect on children's ability to concentrate on one target, their creativity and ability to understand, and also their social interactions. The third is relief from distress. The results of the research showed that watching violence on television was indeed linked to greater aggressiveness in the viewers. However, some other studies pointed out that merely watching violence on the television does not make children more aggressive. Other research findings showed that watching violence may actually reduce the natural aggressive tendency of the viewers. This process is called catharsis. The last is consumerist attitude. It is said that a consumerist attitude has developed, and this is due to television watching. Numerous products are advertised and it is very natural for the viewer to get carried away. So students, today we have completed our chapter 8, and in the next lecture we will start a new chapter.